There's the ding.
Awesome. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. And welcome to our part three session on All About Flow. This session was originally designed when we talked about the Platform App Builder certification. We just decided between Vicky and myself that why not just take a deep dive into all aspects of flow. So for some of the items that you're about to see here today, they won't necessarily be covered in the Platform App Builder exam themselves, but will give you a really good idea about the capabilities of flow and the kind of things that you can start doing with it. I'm going to turn up my noise. Vicky, do you want to introduce yourself by turn the slack off?
Yeah, so my name's Vicky Jeffrey. I'm head of technology at a company called Oshaw. We're here in Brisbane, Australia. I've been using Salesforce for about 10 years now, and been with ADSB Architects for about 2 years or 3 years. I've achieved application architect, and I'm also now on the systems architect track.
Awesome. And I am Adrienne Cutcliffe. Hard thing this morning. I'm a not-for-profit solutions lead for Traction on Demand. I'm also a application architect working my way through the system architect, and now have to go through and change all of my certification names. So for those of you that are any further certified or are looking into some of the new certifications, yesterday Salesforce has changed the name of a number of the architect certifications. So if you are looking for study resources, I will be changing those on our YouTube channel over the next sort of few days. So if they're not quite in the same place that you remember them, don't worry, the names are just slightly changed. Vicky, you do this one.
Okay, so who's ADSB Architects? So it was originally started by Gemma, who's in the UK, and quickly followed joined by Charlie and Susanna. And then myself, Adrienne and Emily joined from APAC to encourage women and everyone in the APAC region to become architects. So that was the premise behind it originally, was that there were not many women architects in the ecosystem. So I think it was 12%, or it might have been 12, I can't remember. We wanted to encourage by leading that women can do this as well. But our content is certainly not just for women.
Awesome. So in getting started, as I mentioned earlier, we started off with the form of doing this around the Platform App Builder certification and covering process, business logic and process automation. Now, the three scenarios that were in there, and if you've joined all the last 3 weeks, this will be the same thing you've heard before, but there were use cases for flow, workflow and process builder. With the announcement at Dreamforce this year, that workflow and process builder will be being sunset and flow will be the new tool, we've decided to focus all our effort on flow and showing everyone exactly what it can do so that when it does come time to upgrade from your workflows and process builders, you're aware of the things that you can do and also how you start achieving that. So what we covered 4 weeks ago now in our introduction session, which you can find on our YouTube channel as well as last week's session, we talked about, the basics, creating flows, flow types, how you use templates and elements. We gave a demo that are on our YouTube channel as well. And we went through some of the resources just to really get you started familiarizing yourself with flow. Last week, we went and started part one of our more advanced session, where we talked about using code, some security in there, how you go about debugging and how you can do error handling and bulkification there as well. And this week, what we're going to be covering is stages within flows, utilizing action and recommendations and Einstein Next Best Actions, local actions, additional elements that we hadn't covered in our previous sessions, how flows can integrate with external systems, the different API versions, all of the limits that Flow has around it, Flow Orchestrator. And then Vicky's going to give us some wonderful demos at the end of some fun, more complex stuff that she's been building over the last week. So without further ado, I'm going to hand to Vicky to talk about flow stages.
Okay, so flow stages allows us to put the stages of a screen flow, well, the screens of a screen flow into stages. So you would add stage resources for each stage. You're going to define flow.active stages and flow.current stage with an assignment element at the beginning of your flow. And if you haven't selected active by default on your stage resource, then it's not, those aren't going to populate. Or you're going to assign with a custom component in your screen element. So that's another way to assign your stages. You do need a custom component to display the flow stages in a path. So that graphic at the top there, you need to create a custom component for that, but they're downloadable. You can find resources. I think there's some on the AppExchange as well, but you can find resources easily to download those flow components at the click of a button. You must have My Domain enabled, and you must have Lightning Runtime for Flows enabled. We go to the next slide. So what does this look like? A little bit hard to see, but it is the stage variable at the top there. So you're actually going to create a variable that has stage as its type. Here's the aura component on the right. So that is the component that's been created as an aura component that you can download, as I said, and you put that onto your screen, and then you're going to put your parameters on the right there, with your current stage being flow.current stage and your active stages, so flow.active stages for your active stages. And then each time you want to change your stage, you're going to add an assignment element, and that's going to change your stage. Now you can also set that manually inside your components if you want to, if that's the way that you've set it up. Next slide. So this is what it looks like. So we've got our flow and our start element and our other elements, and you can see between each screen we've got an assignment, and each of those assignments moves us to the next stage. So the first assignment, the stage is contract, the next is terms and conditions, and the first one being account and contact. And we would have set that when we put the, when we created the stage variable, to say use this default stage. So that's the one that always shows it at first. And the bottom graphic there, you can see what it looks like. So we go from account and contract to terms and conditions as we move through the flow. Next slide.
Oh, that's me. Awesome. So flow actions and recommendations. So if you're like me, every time you build a Lightning page, you'll see the component that says actions and recommendations. And I never really used it. I have no idea what it did for the first little while when it came out. But essentially, actions and recommendations create a to-do list for your users. They can include things like active screen flows, field service flows, and auto launch flows, global and quick actions, and then just simple recommendations that you're adding in as well to the recommendations object. So new deployments, as they're called, or new actions and recommendations panel, which is the item here, can be created from the actions and recommendations setup menu. And you can actually utilize flows in these. So what you can see down here is an actions and recommendations that I've done every time a user requests that a password be reset. So the first thing is the verify identity flow, then that kicks into a create contact, then that sets into the reset password flow. The question, this feature isn't using Einstein AI, but the next best action is. So this particular actions and recommendations section is actually based on channel. It is either based on chat, phone, or default, I think you can set it. So depending on how you're communicating on the record that you've added it to, I added this one to case, for example. I ended up setting this to default so that I could see it. Now, important things to note with actions and recommendations is that flows and actions and recommendations don't rely on variables being passed from record pages or from other flows in the component. So what you won't be able to see here is if we've got our verify identity, you can't see that it's like auto-populating with the contact name. This is something that you have to enter in yourself. So we're not passing variables in the way that ScreenFlows embedded into the page directly would be passing those variables in. This isn't using AI, so again, it doesn't suggest which ones it thinks you might do. It is just a set list of things that you and the business say, when you get a case, these are some things that you should be doing in order to resolve this. So maybe like, have you updated the status? Did you send a confirmation email? Did you update your notes? And doing that throughout. So when you do have a flow in this component, such as the verify identity or the reset password record, when a user's going through and they select it, it simply pops out in this little pop-up box on top of your record, so you're not redirected away, it doesn't take over the page, and simply walks you through the flow until such a point as you're completed, and then the action disappears. So it's good to use flows just to, you know, do some confirmation there. Maybe you want to create some additional records somewhere else or do some quick creates that are outside of using global actions or object side actions. Cool. So then there's the next best actions component, and this is the part where the Einstein AI actually does come into account. So rather than being a to-do list, like your recommendations and actions, it's the right one. They all have the action word in them. Recommendations and actions, this is actually using the Einstein AI to determine logic and user data to show what your next best action is. So where you're setting a list, this one just says, out of the 10 things that I could be doing based on the information that we've got, or you know, some user input parameters, it's going to suggest to you, hey, I think you should reset this user's password, or the example I stole from the internet, remind the applicant to bring in their ID documentation for day one. With recommendations, other than, again, your actions and recommendations, users have the ability or must have the ability to skip a recommendation or accept the recommendation. If they skip the recommendation, it simply moves on to the next recommendation. If they choose to accept it, in this instance of using a flow, it will actually launch the flow, say in the same pop-out screen, so that you can complete that flow and then continue on. And again, much the same as your actions and recommendations, flows in here can be screen, field service, or auto-launched flows. So when you do set up a recommendation, which is simply just a new object record inside Salesforce, you give it a name and a description, an image if you want to. Then you again must specify the acceptance label, rejection label, and then what happens if they do go through and accept that process. Cool. Local actions. This was a fun one for me because I've never used this one before. But local actions allow users to build or modify custom Aura components, so Lightning components using the Aura framework, to use inside your flows. So that means that when you're running through any Aura components that you do have are executed using what's called client-side logic, and I'll show you what that looks like shortly, that can be invoked by your flow. If you want to use code, so use your Aura components inside of flow, the client-side logic must contain the Lightning available for flow actions markup so that they start appearing. And if you want to add one to your flow, you simply add the new action element and it appears as a core action. So we can see here, I created an Aura Lightning component called Hello World Aura component. I don't stuff around with names. And when I start typing in hello, that's the Aura component that pops up. Lightning components such as this one here, again, much the same as some of the items Vicky mentioned earlier, like your flow stages, will only show up where you have Lightning runtime enabled in your process automation settings. So yeah, this bottom image here is when I was adding it to my flow, and this right-hand side here, because it was a very simple pop-up box, is what it actually looked like when I got to it executing that action within the flow. So what does that look like? essentially what we had previously was this aura component here. All the aura component did was print the words "Hello World" when you clicked on it. We can then see here that we've also done the implements lightning available for flow actions. And then you have your client side controller, which is the controller portion of your lightning component. And this here just tells you what it should be doing and invoking an alert when it goes through.
Okay, so I threw the slide in because I just wanted to touch on custom screen components. We've talked about them a little bit, but there's so much more that you can do with them. I mean, you can install them from AppExchange, or you can build them yourself. So that's Aura or Lightning Web Components, and then they're going to come up in your custom area in your flow, your screen flow element. So you can do things like customize navigation and display data in a table, use branded header, etc. So there's all sorts of things that you can build or steal from other people when you want to show something different than what's just available out of the box. And then, as I said, once your components are built, they're going to show in that custom area as long as you've put available for flow action, and you'll be able to drag and drop them onto your screen. Did we miss one? Okay, so integration with external systems. So we can use Flow to integrate a lot with our what external systems that we're using. And there's a various ways we can do this. So here's a table of what's available to us. So we've got platform events, external objects, custom lightning components, enhanced external services, and Apex. And then we've got whether it's declarative or programmatic. So platform events, external objects, and enhanced external services, they're all declarative, so they're all point and click, while custom lightning components and Apex are programmatic. And then where do they run? So this is important when you start to look at how you're using your resources. So server or client side, and that's the beauty of custom lightning components, is that they're client side. So they're not having to go back to the server often, and that's why local actions work well if you're trying to work behind a firewall or wanting to do something locally. While the other ones all work server side, so they're going to go out to Salesforce servers to do their functionality. And then whether they're synchronous or asynchronous. Now, synchronous means that it's going to wait for a response before continuing. And asynchronous means it doesn't need to wait for a response before continuing. I'm not going to go through those today, but it is important when you start to look at how do you talk to and receive information from external systems. And you can see that platform events is asynchronous only, while external objects and enhanced external services are synchronous, and then you've got both for your lightning components and Apex. So we'll go through some of these. So our first one is platform events. So you can publish an event message with a create records element. So a platform event is essentially it's like an object. It's what it looks like. But it's used to tell the system that something has happened. And if you go to the next slide, you can also subscribe to event messages with platform event triggered flow and a pause element. And also, I know we said we're not going to talk about process builder or in this one, but at the moment, you need to use process builder with an auto-launched flow if you want to use a pause element. So pause elements don't work in record triggered flows at the moment, but hopefully that will change soon as they start to deprecate Process Builder. Next slide. All right, so external objects. So sometimes you need to reference data that's external to Salesforce, and you can create external objects inside Salesforce to reference that external data. So Salesforce can see and expose to you the data that is actually in an external system. And then you're just going to use your standard get, create, or update elements with that external object, which will update data outside of your org. Next one. Oh. Where are we at? Okay, so custom lightning components. Now I've stolen some of Adrian's screenshots here just to fill in that space and show you what we're talking about here. So when you're dealing with external systems, you can use custom lightning components. You're going to use your local actions to connect to those. So that's if it's behind your firewall and you can access it with a local action, then that's how you're going to access your external system. And then you're just going to use an action element in your flow to access that local action.
So some good examples that I've seen of this here in Australia, we have to verify businesses using a 10-digit number. So I've seen this used in flows before, where what happens is they enter in their 10-digit number. The integration actually goes out to an external system that verifies with the government that that exists and then returns that back into the screen flow. So that's just some examples of how you can be utilizing these local actions to integrate with those external systems. Really trying to only click once because I keep, for some reason, going too far.
So you can also do that with enhanced external services. So this is designed as a declarative a function for you, where it will create those APEX classes for you when you enter the data into an enhanced external service in your setup. And then those APEX classes are going to appear in your flow builder as APEX actions. And you can declaratively connect your external REST APIs using the Open API standards. So you're going to register an external service. You need a named credential with an Open API endpoint, so that's your URL that connects you to the system, and you need its authentication parameters. So that's all added in as external services and setup, and then you can access those in flows. So the examples there are, you might be going to a credit scoring service or a digital payment service or a mapping service or a government service, like Adrian described with Australian business numbers. Next slide. Okay, so APEX, I've got some screenshots here, but it's really similar to what we did last session, where you're going to use APEX to integrate with your external system. You make your APEX code available in Flow Builder. You're going to by using either the @invocable method, or you're going to use something called a process plugin. But the @invocable method is recommended because process plugin doesn't support blobs, collections, S objects, and time data types. And it also doesn't support bulk operations. So there's a recommendation definitely to use the @invocable method rather than process plugin, unless for some reason you need it. And I'm not an experienced developer, so I'm not sure exactly why you would need to use that. Next slide. So here we've got some examples of what does process plugin look like. So we've got our constructor signature at the top where we're calling it. So we're saying process.plugin request, and then we need to instantiate it, which is what we're doing in the second one. We're saying what are those parameters that we need to call. And our @invocable method at the bottom, that shows you how we do the same thing, but we're using the @invocable method there. Okay, so API versions. So Salesforce has brings out API versions all the time, often with each release. So, but when you create a flow, it will run by default in the latest API version, and it will remain in that version until you change it. You don't have to change it unless there's some reason for you to do so. If a version update is released, then all your flows in your org will get the updated behavior regardless of the API version. So that's a little different to upgrading, to going in and selecting the newest API version. And that you access API version in your flow properties. And the release notes tell you what is actually changing in there. So there's changes all the time in the API. You do need to go into your flows and update those API versions. They don't update automatically.
Did it again, but this is the right slide that should be on. I'm now 90. Yeah, presential. So over the next three slides, we're going to talk about some of the entitlements that you have within your Salesforce when you're using Flow. Some of these numbers don't mean a lot of things to a lot of people. I still have a hard time explaining some of them to myself. But essentially, there's three different types of limits and entitlements that you get for Flow. The first is your usage-based entitlements. So this varies dependent on the addition of Salesforce that you have. So those of you that are Salesforce administrators, you can find your addition in your company information section. But depending on whether you're using the essential professional, performance or developer, or enterprise or unlimited, these figures will change. So where we talk to some of these limits, maximum paused and waiting Flow interviews talks about ones that have been paused and groups of scheduled actions from processes. So you can have for an enterprise or unlimited up to 50,000 paused or Flow interviews. But some of these we will also take into account in the next slide as well. So that's 50,000 at a time. Maximum Flow interviews with the UI per month. So that's in the user interface, such as screen flows, field service snap-ins when users provision them, survey builders and things. So that's any flows that your users have to interact with. And this is interviews. This is each time it's run on a per month basis. So each time one of these is started off. Is that, Vicky, can you confirm that for me as well? I realized I forgot to research this. Does it count as an interview if you have a screen flow on a record page? Does it start, or does it only start when you click the next button? Do you know?
I think it starts when you click the next button, but I'd have to confirm it.
Yeah. We will look into that and come back to everyone. One thing I forgot. The maximum Flow interviews without UI per month. So our auto-launched, our transaction flows, also inclusive of processes built in Process Builder and your record triggered flows. So this is how many interviews or how many times they can run per month. So look, if you can run more than 10 million things, doing very well, 10, yeah, that's a billion, and that is just the same, I think. And that's all the same zeros. Yep. So you do have a pretty hefty limit on the number of flows that you can be running on a monthly basis. If you are running more than that, or you do start hitting limits, I would suggest consolidating or working out if all of those actually need to be firing at that point. Additional Flow interviews per month. So in addition to these limits here for the UI, you can also then, if you have enterprise or unlimited, you get extra on top of your 20 million for each user that you have. So 50 additional for Service Cloud, 50 additional per content license, and for unlimited, 100 additional per Service Cloud and 100 additional per content license. So then we start to talk about our Flow limits. So this is then your per org limits and how many things that you can create for your Salesforce overall. And again, this one is split dependent on your org type. So essentials and professionals, and then everything above those. So enterprise, unlimited, performance or developer. So versions per flow, and we talked about this in our first session, but they're both 50. So what that means is when you're doing a save as new version and you're creating a new one, Salesforce will let you get up to 50 before it tells you you have reached your maximum flow versions. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't create any more flow versions. You then have two options there to either deactivate that flow and create a brand new flow, or simply go to the view details and versions section and just start deleting old versions. Likely, if you're at version 50, you probably don't need versions like 1 through 10 anymore. Executed elements at runtime per flow. So this is the elements within it, it's up to 2,000. Active flows per flow type. So for our lower level orgs, our essentials and professionals, you can have 4 active flows per flow type, which, as we've mentioned, are things like auto-launched flows, so 5 of those. I've forgotten all the flows. Screen flows, record triggered flows, things like that. So you can only have 5 active at a time, and you can only actually have 5 of those in total at a time. However, for some of the higher level orgs, you can have 2,000 and 4,000. Flow interviews that are resumed per hour or groups of scheduled actions or processes that are executed per hour on a specific time. So this is where I talked to you before that while you can have a large number of paused or awaiting flow interviews, Salesforce has a limit and will only process 1,000 of those per hour. Otherwise, you're putting too much load on your system and simply asking for it to process too much. You might start hitting all your other sorts of governor and processing limits. Resume events. So this is when you're resuming paused flows, groups of scheduled actions, time triggers in workflow rules, and inactive flow interviews that are resumed, you have up to 20,000. And then scheduled triggered flow interviews are a 24-hour period. So if you're running flows that run, say, every day, once a week, once a month, it's 250,000 by the number of user licenses by 200. So it's either 250,000 or by the number of user licenses multiplied by 200. So if you have more than mathed users, you get more. Up to 250,000. We then have our per transaction limits. So this is then per sort of time the flow is running and transacting. So the total number of SQL queries issued. So that includes all executions within it of get records, update records, or delete records. And you can use 100 of those per transaction. So it's combining all of those update, create, delete, et cetera, elements together. The total number of records retrieved by those SQL queries. So this was a question that we had from a member last week as to how many it will actually get in a one record. And the answer to that was 50,000. Total number of DML statements used. So this is the same kind of per code, but the amount of create and update and delete executions that you can have. It's 150. Total number of records processed as a result of those DML statements is 10,000. So that means in one flow, it probably wouldn't recommend updating sort of more than 10,000 in one go. The maximum CPU time, so the maximum amount of time it will allow it to run is 10,000 milliseconds. And the number of duplicate updates allowed in one batch is 12. So this is where some of the tips and tricks where Vicky and I talked to you about is that if you do have larger flows that do need to perform multiple updates to a record, it's always best to use multiple assignment variables to prepare all the way throughout and then do one big update to your object at the end to prevent doing sort of updates and updates and updates to the same records. Vicky.
Okay, so Flow Orchestrator. Now this is in beta, so which basically means that if you have a problem with it, it may not be supported until it's generally available. But I've done a deep dive into it and it's pretty good. So I thought I'd share with you, what is it? What is it going to do for us and how does it work? So basically what it is, it combines multiple flows to execute your business processes. It uses auto-launched and screen flows. So you can see in the screen graphic there that I've gone to a new flow, I've selected All Plus Template, I've selected Flow Orchestrator, and then the two options I've got are auto-launched orchestration or record-triggered orchestration, and I'll go through what those are. So it organizes all your flows into stages and steps. Steps are organized by stages, and as I said, it's auto-launched or record-triggered only. The next slide. Okay, so what are stages? So you're going to create a stage inside your flow orchestrator, and you're going to set your steps and your exit condition. So you can only be in one stage at a time, but you can be in multiple steps at a time. So it could be going through multiple steps within your stage. And I'll show you how it looks on the page later, but this just we'll just start to go through what each element is inside these this orchestrator. So the next one. So you've got two steps. You've got a background step and an interactive step. So your background step, that runs in the background. So that's like your flow that you don't need any user interaction for. And for these, you're going to set your entry condition. you're going to select your flow and add in your input variables. So you're going off and selecting a flow that you've created elsewhere to put inside your flow orchestrator, and you're passing in your variables. So that's going to might be from the record that it's been created from, or it could be from a screen element in a previous flow that's in a previous stage. So you can use your variables from other stages to pass into your new steps and stages throughout the orchestrator. Next step, our interactive steps. So these ones are the ones that require user input. So they're going to be your screen flows. Again, you're going to set an entry condition to get into the step. So you're not going to move into that step until the entry condition has been met. And then you're going to select your flow and again set your input variables. You're going to specify the record page that the step will appear on. Now, this is really interesting because what it allows us to do is that if we've got one flow, so the idea behind Flow Orchestrator, it's going to show in one component, but you can move that component between records. So you might start out on an account record where maybe you want to create a case and work through the case. And then as you start working through the case, you can then take that component and put it inside your case record. So you're moving to a different record. It doesn't have to stay on the one object or the one record as you work through your flow orchestrator. And you can also specify an assigned user. They may also have group or queue in GA, but it's just user at the moment. And then you're going to set your exit condition. So your exit condition is what happens, how do we get out of this flow? So it's when the assigned user has completed the screen flow, the stage is marked complete, or when the specified evaluation flow returns true. So you can have a separate step where you're specifying what needs to be true to get through to the next stage or step. Next one. So what are our variables inside Flow Orchestrator? So they are stages and steps and outputs. So the output and status for stages and steps is what's available to you as you work through the flow, but also all of your variables that have come in through your flow integrations or the flows that you've selected. Next slide. All right, so what other elements are available for us? So it's really the decision element. So we make a decision based on what is happening. So it could be that your decision is based on previous variables or something else that's come through from your record, which would be a variable anyway. So then you can decide which way do you want to go, which allows you to move on to stages in one direction or another direction. So this is the same as a decision element inside your flow, essentially. Okay, so how do you display it on your screen? So you're going to use a component called the Flow Orchestrator Work Guide, and it stays on your screen, unfortunately, even if the record is not in the flow. But if you set a parameter inside your flow, so you might have a checkbox in your record to say only display if the Flow Orchestrator is active. And you would set that inside as a step inside your flow orchestrator to set that to go, so that component is only going to display if it's inside the flow, but it's not a default option at the moment. And all screen flows will appear inside that work guide, as I said, so it's all flows are in the one area rather than having to put in different components for each flow. And as I said, you can handle it with component visibility, so putting in that checkbox when the record is in the flow. Next one. So the last one is monitoring. So you can look at your flow orchestration history. At the moment, you look at it by clicking on the flow name inside that component. It's not yet available in Report Builder, so you can't use it in Report Builder. And I don't know if you can yet see the stages. It wasn't available in the pilot, but it may be available in the beta if you can see where we're at and what date and time each stage was reached, or each stage and step was reached. So that's really a deep dive into Flow Orchestrator. I know that they're planning some more stuff in there around how to use it, but it's a really good one to look into. I think it's going to be quite key in how we start to use flows inside our Lightning pages. Okay, so use cases, our demo. So I've created a few flows to go through to look at how we use integration with external platform. So our use case is our Universal Containers company has an integration with an external platform. They need to send an account to the external system from the account in Salesforce when the user is ready to send that account. So it's not going to be automatic. It's going to be when the user presses a button. The external account ID then needs to be entered into the external ID field in the Salesforce account. And then when an account is updated, the update needs to be sent to the external system. And when a successful update is received, the external updated date time field needs to be updated to the current date time. And that's a field in the account. So I'll just go through the next two slides, Adrian, before I take over the screen share.
Okay.
So what are we going to do? So we're going to create an external account. So when an account is created, a user controls when a client is created in the external system by clicking a button in the Salesforce account. And that's our create client externally flow, which I'll show you. Error handling needs to be used to ensure that specific fields are filled out before the new client can be created in that external system. So we've got some mandatory fields in the external system that we need to make sure are populated or filled out before it's sent off. And then once created, the Salesforce account external ID field needs to hold the external ID field from the external system. So our first flow is going to be that we create a screen flow that's going to check if the fields are filled out and prompts the user to fill them out if they aren't. We're going to use a quick action to put a button on our screen to be able to activate that flow. And then we're going to create a platform event for the external system to subscribe to. And we need to run the flow in system context because not all users have access to the platform event, and nor do we want to give it to them. And then for the second flow, we're going to create a platform event triggered flow, which is going to subscribe or wait for a platform event to be received from the external system to say that that creation has been successful or unsuccessful. We'll handle that as well. It's going to then populate the account with the external ID field and update the external updated date time field so we know when the last update was received from the external system. And then the next one. Then we're going to move on to what happens when when we want to update that external account. So when our account is updated, we're going to check if the external system fields have been updated and the external ID has a value. So if that's the case, we want to go and update our external system. Then it's going to automatically send an update to the external system. And this is where I'm going to show you how to use a pause. We wouldn't always do it this way, but it's a good demo to show you. So then we need to wait for the external system to respond. And once we've got that response, we're going to update the external updated date time field with the current date and time. We're also going to handle what happens if it's a failed response. So we're going to use Process Builder for this. And the reason that we need to use Process Builder is because our pause options aren't available in our record triggered flows yet in Flow. So we need to create the platform, process builder. I've put platform builder, it's process builder, and an auto launch flow to handle it. The platform builder, process builder runs when the account is updated and the external ID field has a value and the system fields are changed. And I've put platform builder for all of these, but it's process builder. I've got myself confused between platform events and process builder. So the process builder calls the flow and sends the variables from the account to the flow. And the flow then is going to create a platform event for the external system to subscribe to. And then we're going to wait. We're going to put a pause in and wait for a response. And that then updates the account with the current date and time. Okay, so if I share my
hand over screen share to Vicky now, and she's going to do clearly a much more comprehensive demo than I did last week.
They're actually really simple when you look at them, so it sounds like a lot, but it's not a difficult thing to do. All right,
over to you, Vic.
Okay, so I'm going to do my entire screen so I can Hang on. Just pop that down. All right. So the first thing we're going to do is go through the flow that creates the account externally. So what we're doing in here is we're going to go and look, make a decision to look at, are our mandatory fields populated? Initially, this is a screen flow, so it will run from a button, which I'll show you in the account in a minute. So we're looking at our decision. So we're making a decision here, are our mandatory fields populated? So our mandatory fields are industry, billing city, billing zip, postal code, and account phone. And we're saying, is null true? So are these blank? If that's no, then it's going to do something. Otherwise, it's going to be our default outcome. So what happens if our mandatory fields are not populated? Then we're going to go to our screen. And our screen shows each of the fields that we want to make sure are populated. And we're putting a default value of record ID and whatever the field is. So when we when the process builder launches, it's going to pass those variables into this flow for us to be able to display in this screen. So I'll show you what that looks like soon. So if it's blank, obviously it's going to come up blank, and you're going to get an error message to say please enter a city. And those are all set with component visibility to say if that field is blank, then show this. If it's not, then don't show it, because we don't want to pop up a red message if they've actually got something in those fields. So with all of these are dragged across from here. They're all text fields, except for the first one, which is a record pick list that I've got directly from the account with a pick list choice set. And then these are display text. So they're simply putting in, please select an industry for this one, and then making it bold and red. All right, so what happens if they change fields? Because they could change those other fields as well inside that screen. So we're going to do an assignment, which assigns back into the record ID, which is our account ID, all of these fields that are either changed or not changed. And if they're not changed, it's okay. We can still update them. And I think that if they aren't changed, when we do the update, it actually doesn't update them. So it recognizes that they're the same and only updates the ones that are changed. So then what happens? So if our mandatory fields are populated, it's going to go directly into our create our platform event. So in our platform event, we're creating one record, we're using separate resources and literal values, and where the platform event name is external account, so that's what's sitting in there. And we're going to say, populate all these fields inside our platform event with the fields inside, that one should be record ID industry, so I should change that, but with all of the assignments that have been put into our record ID, which is our account ID. And the reason we've done it this way, and I need to change that, but I won't till later, is that we've got two paths into this. So if I only put the stuff in the screen, which I've accidentally put here, then nothing's going to come in if the mandatory fields are populated. So I won't change it now, but that's a mistake on my part. Then what happens if there's a fault? So here's our fault path. So if there's a problem, something happens. In this case, it would be that I've stuffed it up and I've put screen in and there's not going to be a screen and it's mandatory. Then it goes to the fault path in here, which is going to create a case record. And we talked last time about some best practices around handling error handling. So here we're using an error code. So the case is going to be populated with an error code, error CA0001. So that when we look at our flow, we can immediately say, what has happened? It's faulted here. And you would have, in a larger flow, you're going to have multiple fault paths. So you need to know which one you're looking at. And then it's going to pop up with a screen to say, there was an error when sending your account to the external system. I'm going to put the case number in here. as to which case has been created so that the user knows that to look, what case they need to look at. And if they want to, they can give the admin the error code of CA0001 so the admin understands if they need to someone to look at it straight away.
I just want to, wanted to go back and I guess touch on Vicky's when she mentioned the screen flow portion as well. So that's where we talked to before the amount of, you know, some of the DML exceptions and the multiple updates that you're doing in some of those rows. The benefits of using something like Record ID, even if it's yes or no, is that because we're technically in that assignment updating that variable, if it hasn't changed, then it's still Record ID. If it has changed, it's with the updates that we've provided in the rest of the document. So you don't need to create all those additional variables. We're like, oh, did my screen flow change from my original record? Should I be updating this field or not? So it takes out a lot of logic by simply going in, because what happens is that if it's not updated, it stays as is because it's the default value. And that does the same thing for the rest of those fields.
So I'll change this one in here now to show you what I mean. So I'll go from, I don't want that value in there of city screen. I do want the record ID. So I'll get rid of that. And I've got my record ID variable here. You can see it's a count. If I click on that and I want city, which is billing city. So I've got all of the fields available to me from the account. And I'll click billing city. So you can now see that that's changed to record ID billing city. And I'll click done. I'll actually save this as a new flow. So I'm going to save it. And then I'm going to activate it. So now it's my running flow. Okay, so if we have created the platform event, we want to go and update the record. So in this one, all we're saying is just go and update that record ID, which is our account ID, so our account. And with anything that's changed. So all we've got to do is say update the record collection in here or record in here. My other option is that I specify conditions. So if I want to and I want something specific not to update, I can specify the conditions to identify records and set those fields. And our very last element is our screen, so it's going to display to the user your account has been sent to the external system. Now this update records, if you didn't realize, it's coming from this assignment, so this is why we want to change it. So if anything has changed in the screen, we want it to go and update the account as well. And then we're running a system, so you can see up here it says runs a system. And that is in our advanced flow settings. So you've got the options here, system context without sharing access or data. That's what I've chosen. And your other two options, user or system context, a screen flow is going to run in user context based on the running user. If you don't set system context with or without sharing. All right. So what does this look like to us? So if I go back to our account here, so this is the account that I want to send to the external system. And you can see here that we've got our external ID and external updated date time fields, which are blank. And I've got my button up here. So that's our process builder button. And what that looks like is a basic process builder that is running on when an account is created or updated. It could only be when an account record is created. And then it checks to see, this is not what I'm after. Hang on a minute. I want the action, not process builder, action, first fail, which I will have to get for you. Hang on a minute. So in our object, which I didn't get the screen, we've got an action, not a process builder. So I want to go to our account and I want to find our buttons, links and actions. And here's my create account externally button or action. And that's going to create that button on the screen. So what I'm doing is I'm just saying, we'll edit it. The flow that I'm getting is create account external. So that's our flow. The label I've put in is create account externally. You can put whatever you want, and the name to refer to it for API is create account externally with underscores. All right, so we go back to our account, and that's where our button is there. So I've also put it on the page layout so that it can be seen. So if I click, I've made sure that I've got take out, say, the phone field so that our screen actually does come up. If I click create account externally, it's going to pop up with our screen. It's going to give the values of the fields that are in our account because I've told it to. I've told it to make the default value as whatever is in the fields in our account. But it's saying you need to enter a phone number. Now, if I got rid of postcode, so let's make postcode something else. I'll get rid of it first. It's going to pop up with, oh, now you please enter a postcode if I delete it. So I can't do that. So I've got to put in a postcode and a phone number. And then click next, and it's going to go off and do all those other steps that I showed you, and then tell me that the account has been sent to the external system, and then I can click finish. Now our next flow, so that's the first step of actually sending the account to our external system. The next step is about how do we know it's sent? There's no external ID in there yet. So what do we do? How do we know it's sent there? So we've got to make sure those are populated. And so we're going to use our external account create confirmation received flow. So this is a platform event triggered flow. So what's going to happen is we're going to receive a notification from the external system, which creates a platform event inside Salesforce that we're then going to subscribe to. And we're going to do that simply by saying when an external account received platform event is created, then do something. Now I do something as our first decision element. And our decision element says, okay, was it received successfully? And we want record type, the record, which is our platform event type equals create received. I'm putting that in because I'm using this platform event for both creates and updates. So if I say create received, I want to do one thing, but if it's an update type, I want to do another thing. And our record status is success. So there's been a successful creation of our client in our external system. Then that's our first decision. And our second decision is our fail. So if it's not successful, it's going to be a fail. And what happens if it's a fail? So we're going to go and create our case. So there's a problem and someone needs to look at it. So that's, again, using our best practice of putting in a case fault number, an error number, and goes and creates a case for us. I've not put any of the fields in here, but you would. It's just really to show you that that's what we would do. And then our receive successful. So if it has been received successful, we want to go off to our account and update those records. So I'm saying if the ID equals the record of the Salesforce ID, so we've got to go and put a condition in there, then because it's not the platform event that starts this flow. So we want to set the external ID to the external ID that's coming from the external system. And I'm just going to put today, which is a date time formula, which I'll show you. Because I'm just going to say it's just been updated. So we can either grab a date and time from our external system to say this was the date time, or you can use the formula field in Salesforce depending on what your requirements are. So that formula is simply a formula variable of now. So it's just going to put the date and time of right now into that field.
Before Vicky moves on, I'm going to sound like an absolute broken record, but I wanted to highlight the wonderful work Vicky has done here in renaming her default path in her decision. So I love to tell people this, always, always rename your default path. Don't just leave it as default path. The reason being, if you've got a decision that branches off into five or six different things, your users might not know what the default path is. So they would have to come in and look at, you know, what are all the other five things do? And if it doesn't do that thing, then what does my default path do? If you're very easily coming in and saying the default path is records, like of this, do the default, saves any confusion and having to troubleshoot and going back and forth. In instances like this where it's either a success or a fail, it's always nice and easy, but always, always name your default path. It's going to do you a load of good in the future if you happen to forget what it's doing.
Awesome, makes sense. All right, so this one is going to be triggered if we receive a platform event. And the way we can test this is through something like Workbench or Postman, where you actually put in your parameters to simulate the creation of that platform event in Salesforce. What actually does go and create that platform event. So if you haven't used Workbench before, this is what Workbench looks like. You need to log in using your Salesforce sandbox or production, depending on what you're doing, user credentials. And then here I've gone to the REST Explorer. So I'm creating, using the REST API to create this platform event, sending it to Salesforce, which will then go off and create the event with my parameters in here. So I use POST because I want to create an event, a platform event. And this is the path I use. So I've got version 52, which is my API. It's going to go off in the S and create an S object, which is account external, external account received underscore underscore E. E is relating to platform event. So with other events, with other objects, it's not going to be E. And I want to actually populate some fields. So I'm putting in the request body. I want, as a Salesforce ID, I want to send back this. And we're using that to populate alpha. Well, we can use the Salesforce ID if you've got an external system to populate, to link what Salesforce ID you're using inside Salesforce. And we're going to use that. So that's how we link up the account. I'm going to populate the external ID with a number, which is the external ID field from my external system. There's my create received. So that's my status or my type. And then my status is success. So those are the fields that you saw inside the flow that we want to, in our decision to see if we're going to update the account or not. So what I do here is I click execute. And then it's going to come, it logged me out. So this is how you log into Workbench. You just need to log in with Salesforce. So
do you mean to log in. Logging into production right now?
Hang on.
I'm sure work might not appreciate.
No, it is, I think, because it's Let me just log out because I want to make sure that I'm not logging into
the wrong one.
Yeah.
This is important for those
on the call. No, here we go. So it will say, which one do you want to log into? And here's my org. So I think with demo orgs, it's production.
Yeah. But always important if those of you that maybe do consulting or have more than one org, definitely check where you're about to push and update data to. Yes. I've done that before. I've built something in the entirely wrong org and, push stuff to it. So always, always check.
All right, so I can jump to something in here, but I'll show you how to. We just want to use REST Explorer. So this is how we get to REST Explorer, and we're going to change it to POST. And then I've got some data on my other screen, so I'm just going to copy and paste that to save time. So if I paste that in, which is the same as we said before about creating that platform event. And I'm going to put my request body in, which is my fields and field values. Right, now let's click execute. Okay. Right, so it comes back and it tells us that it's successful. Success is true. So that means it's gone to our system. So we'll go back to United Oil and Gas. And if the demo has worked, and I refresh it, crossing fingers, then that external ID and the date and time has been filled out for us.
You've got further than I did this week.
Yeah. So that's our update, and also how to create, how to simulate creating a platform event inside Salesforce. All right, we've got one more. We've got this, what happens when we want to update an account. So this is an auto launch flow and with a process builder, which I started to talk about before by mistake. So we're using this because we can't use a pause element inside a record triggered flow. If I wasn't using the pause element, I would just create a record triggered flow and put in my parameters for that based on when someone updated the account. But I can't do that because I've got this pause element. So at the moment, we create our process builder. It's based on our account being created or updated for the, in this one. And it's, are these different fields changed? So when something happens and someone changes these, go and update our external system. And then it calls our platform event and passes in some field parameters. So you can see that I'm passing in the external ID, the account ID, postcode, industry, city, and phone. So those are our fields that we want to pass in. And then the audit, the flow will start. So it's auto launched based on that process builder. And we're going to go off and create our platform event. So that's our external account. And for some reason, I've just put industry in here. It should have more fields. That's a bit slack, but we would have all of our fields in here that go off and create the platform event for us. So you'd populate them by going, okay, I need specific fields, and then go in and create them. So, and then we're going to do a pause. So this pause is based on always pausing. So it's just going to pause and wait for a response. So we don't need a default path, and I haven't changed the default path name here because it's not actually needed. It's always going to run this pause for us. And then it's going to update records. So once it's received the platform event, actually I need to go back and show you what happens when it resumes. So we've got our pause condition, always pause, and then resume. So when it resumes, it's when a platform event is received. And our platform event is our external account received. So when I was talking before in the presentation about how you can run a platform event based on a pause, this is what I was talking about. So you put your platform event in here and the conditions. So our conditions in here is that I want the type to be update. So if I get a create received, I don't want this to run. The status is successful and the external ID is the same as the external ID in my record. You can leave a message as well if you want to, but you don't have to. And then we go off and update the account. So all we're doing with this account is updating the external ID and the date and time. So why? I really want to update the date and time in here. Let's see. Oh, I have actually. I need to update the account that has the same external ID as my external system. And then I want to update just the date and time with that same formula, which will be now. Okay, so let's go back to this record. And we're going to update something. So let's just go in. So we know that we've got the external IDs populated here. We're going to go in and change this field. And we're going to click save. These are always the worst parts of demos. Are they actually going to work? And we know it's worked if it comes up in the scheduled jobs, because it would have gone through this element to this element and then paused. So if I go refresh here, so what I'm looking at here is my paused flow interviews. So you can get to this by going into setup and going to paused and failed flow interviews. And here's my update account external. So it's sitting there, it started the first part, and it's now waiting for a platform event for us to be received to state that update has been successful. So I'm going to go back to Workbench And I'm going to have to copy this over, I think. So I'll try and execute it. But what is happening here is I'm saying, okay, so let's create that external account received platform event. But this time it's going to be only sending the external ID number, which is the same number in our account that we've populated in the create. The type this time is going to be update, but our status is still going to be successful. So let's see if I can execute this without it. Nope. Because it logged me out. So I'm just going to copy this over to that other screen because we're logged in here. It's actually the same, so I don't need to copy that bit, but I do need to change that request body. So now if I execute this, and let's cross fingers that it works and doesn't log me out again. Success, it's successful. And if I go back into here, it should, and I refresh this, it should be gone. So it's received it. And then if I go back into my account, when I refresh, this should have changed from 910 to about 916 or 917. So if I refresh this, it's now saying 9:16 a.m. And that is how you create and receive platform events out of and into Salesforce. So the end of our demo, thank goodness. All right.
You did it.
So I'll just grab our...
Oh, you've got it. Awesome.
I've got it, yep.
Faze is doing the swappy screen sharing.
Yeah. Okay, so
these tips and best practices are really the same tips and best practices that you've heard us say the last few weeks in a row. So not gonna go through all of them again, but just touch on the ones that really are important that we've reiterated through this presentation, being not to like to do the database changes at the end of your flow and to really utilize that assignment option. I find it before I started using it, I didn't know, and it's a really underrated option. It allows you to just update everything without actually updating everything until you get right to the end. So try, if you can, to do all your database actions at the end of the flow. Don't do DML statements inside of a loop. Again, assignments are my favorite now. Make the update in the assignment, add the updated record to a list, update the collection at the end. Make sure you do that error handling. Use that fancy get element if you want to hard code record type IDs. Always, said it a couple of times, always rename your default paths, whether that's a default path for your pauses or a default path for your decisions. It's just the bane of my existence when I don't know what it's doing. I have to come in and look afterwards. And look, if you are using sort of multiple limits, always try to see where you can consolidate your flows, and always best to make sure that if you are doing things like record triggered flows or auto launch flows, that the things that are launching those have some type criteria, or if it is on every create and update, to have one singular flow that passes out. If you're not tightening that criteria with things like your record triggered flows, it's going to run it every single time, which is going to take up some of those flow interviews. So we talked to limits and the fact that it processes 1,000 in an hour. If they've got really loose criteria and you're executing one flow that executes another six, you're doing yourself a disfavor when it comes to things like data imports, updating of records, things like that. So, which really goes in line with the first one, plan your flow, but not just plan your flow. Plan your flow in conjunction with other flows. If you're an administrator, what else do you have? Can you reuse something that you've already got and maybe just add an extra decision in to split it off? I'm in the nonprofit space, so I have one flow trigger on opportunity that literally has a decision that says, is this a recurring donation? Is this a one-off donation? Is this a matching gift? Is this all of the different kinds of donations? And then goes on and does all my assignments and updates from there. So plan it out in conjunction with your other flows if you can combine. It also limits the amount of flow interviews that you're running to keep your limits low and how many times they're going to run.
Sorry. Oh,
two screen problem. any other things that you have, Vic, for
best practices? Think of, no. Mm-hmm. No. No?
Nope.
So if there's any questions about the flow demo, and hopefully that made sense to you. If it doesn't, just yell out.
Anything else? I do have 10 minutes. Are there any other questions that anyone wants to ask about a flow that maybe you're building at the moment? Please do let us know. Or in the future, Vicky, you can decide if you want to do this or not. But if you do have flow questions, I'm more than happy for you to reach out via email or LinkedIn or Twitter.
Definitely.
Yep. So our emails are my first name, Vicky's first name, at ladies-b-architects.com. So the same as our website domain, if you ever want to get a hold of any of us. We love to answer questions. I love to find out new things about flow all the time. So Vicky, just want to click to the next slide super quickly.
Yep.
So last but not least, we mentioned last session that this was our last study group of the year. We have also announced today, and we'll have a registration page up shortly, and a little LBA holiday party. So we're going to be doing some Salesforce trivia, some Ohana trivia, some general trivia, really just hanging out with each other, really. So this is more of a, I guess, Australian, late New Zealand, sorry, Sarah, early morning UK time session. So this is currently scheduled for 7 a.m. GMT, which is 7 p.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time and 8 p.m. Australian Daylight Savings Time, which is about 10 p.m. in New Zealand, so not super bad, but late. Sorry for the US-based people, we're working something out. But if you have gotten a kick out of it, you want to do some trivia, take a little break, don't have anything to do on a Friday night or early Friday morning, then please join us for our holiday party. Again, we'll post the registration link on our website, Twitter, LinkedIn's, et cetera, in the coming day or so.
Okay.
I really haven't got the rambling out of my system yet this morning.
All right. So if there's no other questions, this is our wrap up for study sessions for the year. And I think I haven't looked to see what the next study session is, but it will be early next year. So we'll kick them off again.
Probably won't be until about February.
Yep, holiday period over, and we'll carry on with the remaining portions of the Platform App Builder set.
Awesome. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Best of luck with studies over the Christmas period. Best of luck with the holiday period, New Year's, and Ladies Be Architects looks forward to seeing you at the Christmas party or in the new year. Thanks, everyone.
See ya.